See, this editorial in Nature, a little over a year back, according to NSF, about one quarter of research articles in 2010 featured authors from more than one country. Up in 20 years from 10% has gone to 25%. And the average number of authors in research papers now stands at 4.5, doubled since 1990. Of course, you look at papers from CERN, the accelerator, Large Hadron Collider, their authors are 300, 200, like that. It's a huge number of people working in high energy experimental physics. And in this context, we should look at what are the beneficial models where we can leverage international collaboration, while at the same time, we preserve our intellectual property. And this is an interesting article last year from William Press, testing speech rather, published in Science, AAA's president. And what he says is, which I have been saying, but he has put it in a, I have never seen the word appropriability used. How many of you know the word appropriability? It's an interesting word. And it comes from appropriating something, you know, take away something. And appropriability comes from that. And what he says is the nature of basic research is such that its results immediately flow to the rest of the world. The moment you publish, your knowledge is now global knowledge from that point. In fact, from the point it reaches the referee. This is the danger point there, but I won't talk about that. But at least let us take, assuming the referees are all honest guys who don't tell their friends who are working in the same field what you have published, you know. And the guy who can do the follow-up applied research and technology development, he's the guy who will benefit maximally from it, So you know, you need both. You need basic research, you need applied research. Basic research gives you prestige. Applied research gives you prosperity, applied research, innovation, technology development, and of course strategic worth. See, they were at one time, America was not so much worried because its main competitors, Japan and Europe, they lacked the capacity to absorb US basic research and take over, do the applied work before the Americans could do it. Now with the internet and the things moving so fast, they are, anyone, anywhere can potentially be the entrepreneur who recognizes the economic potential of scientific discoveries. So you take the old days, Bell Labs discovered the principle of the transistor, made money out of the transistor. But no longer it is possible. That's why you find even in Bell Labs the support for basic research has gone down. They are saying, let somebody do the basic research, we will pick it up from there and then continue with the applied research. But that becomes the greater responsibility of the government, DBT, Sinha ji, to support basic research. Because all governments over must have the increased responsibility to. So their aim is, the first path forward is to adopt policies, according to William Press, that maintain the appropriability of returns. That is, you appropriate that knowledge and convert it into wealth or strategic value from US basic research to the US economy. Now we must paraphrase these comments, whatever he has said, in the Indian context. What do we do when we do research in our country? Of course we must go for international scientific collaboration. You know, this Large Hadron Collider, which saw the first signature of the Higgs boson a couple of years back, called the God particle. You know how it got the name God particle? God particle? See, Leon Lederman, who had been looking for this particle, which is 150 times the mass of the proton. And you know, the way the Large Hadron Collider works is 100 meters below the ground. There are protons circulating in opposite directions. And when they collide, energy disappears. and you must read the Einstein equation the wrong side. Destroy energy, you produce mass. That's how they do high energy experimental physics. The higher the energy of the colliding particle, the higher the mass of the new particle that you produce. So they had to go to at least 4 tera electron volt protons or hadrons, which are protons, before they could look for it. And because, as I said, 130 and 40 times the mass of the proton. Earlier they had not found it. So he said, for 15 years I have been searching for this goddamned particle and I have not found it. Editor said, remove the damn from it, I can't publish it. So it became the god particle, because if you are a believer, every particle is a god particle. Now, out of this $4 billion worth machine, $40 million worth of equipment India supplied. $40 million. This is an agreement I had signed when I was chairman of Atomic Energy Commission. You know, a dipole magnet bends the beam, but you have to focus it. You have to what they call corrector magnets, the superconducting magnets, sextupole, octupole, decapole, and there are 1500 of them in the 26 kilometer circumference ring. All that was made in India, designed, of course, quality was validated by the CERN guys. And at that time, my colleagues had told me that this $40 million is estimated at European costs. What they can do, we can do at half the price. Actually, what we spent was only about $20 million. And of course, the other arrangements are interesting, allows us access to the machine. The worst thing for me is not only we go and use their machine, you also say, pay me TADA. No, that looks awkward. But now, this other half of the $40 million, $40 million, half of it is taken as our contribution to the machine. The remaining $20 million is an India fund which supports our scientists, not only from DAE, from all over. The main partner for this was the Indore Center for making the superconducting magnets. And the very fact that high-tech Indian equipment has gone into this multi-billion dollar machine shows the quality of the manufacturing skills which India has. Similarly, ISRO. You know, not many people know that the robust polar satellite launch vehicle, PSLV, and they have launched 35 satellites from 19 countries, and commercially, not apart from some experimental ones that they have done. So we must go for international collaboration. After all, we are a civilized country. We must participate in projects which look for ultimate structure of matter, origin of the universe, functioning of the brain. If there is a big international project, eliminating the climate change threat, fighting pandemic diseases, and in major collaborative technology efforts like the fusion one, thermonuclear fusion in Kadrash. And this is where the question of academia-industry interaction comes. Of course, you have explicitly Dr. Nair, where is Dr. Nair? Sitting here, at this Translational Research Institute. You know, the chain is research, development, delivery, research, development, delivery. This is an MIT paper by Kenan Sahin, which is titled Innovation Backlog. He says academic institutions are good in research, poor in development, zero in delivery, by and large. Industry is good in delivery, poor in development, zero in research, by and large. But there are exceptions for both. So here is a system. He's talking of the United States, more applicable to India. Academic institutions are good in research, industry is good in delivery, and we must build this academia-industry interface of a variety of things. You can have, like I said, advisory groups with people from both sides, like we had the car for automotive, CMAT, machine tools, CAREL and all that. Or we can go a little further established, like we talked about the translational research. CAREL, you know, electronics hardware is the most important. Somehow, we have slipped badly in manufacturing in general. But electronics hardware, we got carried away by these IT software services. It's a good thing, you make money. But then we should not have left electronics hardware, everything, telecom equipment. So this core advisory group, which we had two co-chairs, one from industry, one from academic institution, they have identified half a dozen electronic devices. What is there in a set-top box you cannot make? Set-top box, every TV has set-top box. These are all killer applications on which make a lot of money. Personal computers, tablets, smartphones, mic, teller machines, smart energy meters and so on. And each one of them, industry has been involved. We have to go at the micro level and find out. And of course, we must also change wherever necessary policy issues which affect the development of some of these products. And then, you know, when you support research, there are two ways of doing it. If you are already in an established group, 1 crore, 2 crore is fine, you know, helps you to do work because equipment, everything is there. But if you are starting something new like nanoelectronics, we had a brainstorming in our office many years back and decided if we had 100 crores to spend in nanoelectronics in two labs, which are the two labs where you will spend it? We ended up with Institute of Science Bangalore and IIT Bombay. And now this thing has grown, and a very good thing that has happened, and like to some extent it is happening here in your Faridabad cluster labs. You are able to attract young, good young faculty from abroad. You give them world class facilities, these young guys will come. And also when multiple, a dozen departments, 10, 12 departments are there in each one of them, Institute of Science and IIT Bombay, who are all using these nanofab facilities which are world class facility. This is the other method. You want to set up, particularly requiring high quality equipment, of course we must indigenize and also build it, which will come as we go along. We must create such centers of excellence, various specialized fields in our academic. And look at the collaborative, and they have, we said this is a national facility. So we have an Indian nanoelectronics users program with an MOU between the two institutions. And look at the 140 institutions are involved, and papers are also coming, 130 papers, patents. And what India needs, you know, is a synergy, what I call coherent synergy. And because very often, even in courses which you give, faculty is fragmented, super specialized. One can think of it in neurosciences, you can think in cyber security. So now that you have this national knowledge network, which is a low latency network, if you have several institutions where students are there, and faculty in all these institutions, lectures by all the faculty can be heard by all the students. Since it's a low latency network, even question answer is possible. I mean, it's almost as though distance has disappeared. And one of the earliest applications, the National Knowledge Network, I'll come to in a moment, was these classrooms, virtual classrooms. Started the new IITs without faculty. They only said IIT Madras will mentor IIT Hyderabad, but where is the faculty? And how many times can a professor from Chennai go to Hyderabad? And we said we'll put the National Knowledge Network to use. And I talked to the students in Hyderabad. They say it is 90% as good, but once in a while the professor must come and show his face so that we know he's not just an image on the screen. Otherwise it's as good as before. See, as I was saying, India's technology needs range from nuclear to rural. India is not a tiny dot on the map. We are not a Singapore or even a small South Korea and all that. And we have progress. You see, this is Yukio Amano, who was Director General of IAEA. He came to India last year. And he said, India is a leader in the nuclear sector. And he had made comments on our closing the nuclear fuel cycle where you take out the plutonium from heavy water reactors, put it into fast breeder reactors and so on, so that finally we go to thorium. But he also adds, I also appreciate India's willingness to serve as a mentor for other Asian countries that have recently joined IAEA. You know, it's not the, it's a wrong perception.